This video contains spoilers for various Star Wars comics, books, TV shows, and movies. Between Order 66 and the second Death Star, Darth Vader had several brushes with death. Or, should I say, death had several brushes with Darth Vader. The first brush with death, and the most important moment in Star Wars, the Battle of Mustafar, but we all know this story. Obi-Wan cuts his legs off, takes his lightsaber, and leaves Vader as he catches on fire, and then is saved by Palpatine. But he has another brush with death shortly after, when Palpatine tasks Vader with finding and killing a Jedi in order to retrieve their kyber crystal to power his new lightsaber, seeing as Obi-Wan took his last one. On the river moon of Aldalim, he found Jedi Master Kirak Infila, a ripped old dude who had a man bun before man buns were cool. Just kidding, man buns were never cool. But I wouldn't tell this guy that. Kirak was a survivor of Order 66 and had taken something called the Bearish Vow. He refrained from any kind of involvement in the Jedi Order. But one thing he hasn't refrained from is training. He constantly fights his training droid, so he has not lost any of his skills whatsoever. As Vader approaches the planet, his ship is knocked out of the sky. He crashes, and then as his droid starts to do the repairs, he sets off to find his Jedi. Immediately, he sees Kirak up high on a cliff and wastes no time in force choking him from a distance. But Kirak, he's not some measly Imperial officer, so he throws out a burst of energy through the force, knocking Vader back. He then waits for Vader on top of a steep mountain called Pass Val. As Vader makes his way up the mountain, Kirak attacks him by opening up gates to a dam, flooding the area Vader is climbing. Then he's attacked by these giant Raptorans. Vader, of course, fends off the attacks and destroys Kirak's droid, stealing his weapon. Kirak and Vader fight, where I believe Vader probably makes fun of his man bun. I would have made fun of his man bun. But Vader is actually defeated. Kirak uses the force to push Vader off the mountain and into the canyon below. Of course, Vader survives, his anger and rage fueling him. Vader finds Kirak's droid that he threw down the mountain earlier and is able to repair himself with the droid parts. He finds Kirak once again and they battle. This time, probably no jokes about Kirak's hair, seeing what happened last time. Some security personnel intervene and then Vader pushes them off a cliff with the force. Kirak reaches out and saves them through the force as Vader then breaks this water tank that serves the nearby city, causing a huge flood, flooding the entire city. As Kirak tries to stop the flood with the force, Vader reaches out and pulls the lightsaber from Kirak's belt and then just snaps the Jedi Master's neck. He then pushes him into the depths of the newly created lake with the citizens of the flooded city below. 5 years later, a resistance is mounting against the Empire on the planet Ryloth, led by freedom fighter Cham Syndulla and his close friend and former slave Izval. The planet is a vital source of both spice and slave to the Empire. This resistance has really become a problem, so much so that Vader and the Emperor decide to travel to Ryloth together to put a stop to this Free Ryloth movement. They travel with Senator Ornfree Tah aboard the Star Destroyer Perilous. Cham, he has a really impressive spy network, and he receives word that the Senator, along with Vader and the Emperor, will be arriving on the same Star Destroyer. Cham goes about setting a trap for the Star Destroyer, including Clone Wars era Vulture droids, space mines, and even buzz droids. Now, this trap has several layers and it's really genius. In the first wave, the space mines are set in the locations that the Star Destroyer comes out of hyperspace. These mines, they damage the Star Destroyer, but it's still not enough. The shields are still operational. He then has a second wave of mines that essentially bleed the rest of the Star Destroyer shields. The third layer is hundreds of Vulture droids, and inside the Vulture droids were buzz droids. Vader is able to take out a lot of these droids, but it's too late. There are fires all over the Star Destroyer and the shields are completely down. Now, there's a fourth layer of this trap and it's Cham's partner Izval and three teams of fighters board three separate repair shuttles. A call is made out for any repair shuttles to fly aboard the Star Destroyer to help save it from being completely destroyed. They get aboard and they set some explosives around the engine room and the hyperdrive, and as they make their escape, they cross Darth Vader. He kills almost all of them except for Izval and one of the other team members. Vader and Palpatine, along with a few of the Royal Guards, are able to escape in the Emperor's shuttle just before the Star Destroyer explodes. Izval rams the shuttle, damaging it, and as they get close, she sees Vader in the ship. Vader reaches out with the Force and is able to choke both of them inside their shuttle. She barely survives, while the other team member does not. Vader, the Emperor, and the Royal Guards crash their shuttle in the forest below. Now, Chamon Isval's main goal is hunting down the shuttle and killing both Vader and the Emperor. There was this really interesting part here as I was reading. One of the two Royal Guards was simply known as Captain. As they were making a camp in the forest, the Emperor had him take off his helmet to rest, and as he did, he was revealed as a clone. Vader looks across the camp and it made him actually reminisce and think about Rex and Cody and Fives and all of the other clones. Right then, the group is chased by a horde of Lileks. These are giant insectoid species that inhabit the forests of Ryloth. Meanwhile, Cham, Isval, and the Twi'lek hunters find the Imperial shuttle but no Sith Lords. Vader and the Emperor literally slaughter the entire Lilek horde and then they kill the queen inside of a cave. As they emerge out the other end of the cave, they come across a little Twi'lek girl named Drua. The Emperor pulls out his lightsaber. He's gonna kill the girl, but Vader, much faster with his lightsaber, actually stops him. He's able to convince the Emperor that the girl can lead them to her village where they can contact Imperial reinforcements. As they walk through the village, they're greeted kindly by the villagers. Vader and the Emperor, they speak to each other in an old Sith language, and Vader asks the Emperor if he's going to kill the villagers. The Emperor replies no, but you killed them all when you spared Drua. Cham and his rebel group track them down to the village and they surround it. Vader is able to repair an old broken communication device using the skills he had as a child. As he's fixing this old device, he felt the tools in his hands and they felt just as natural to him as his lightsaber. It made him think back to when he made things of metal rather than being encased in it. Now, once it was repaired, they were able to call for an Imperial rescue to the village. As the support ship arrives, Cham, Isval, and the rebels attack. The Emperor boards the shuttle while Vader gives chase to Cham. Isval stops and in a heroic and rather terrible decision, confronts Vader, giving Cham the time to escape. Vader force chokes Isval into unconsciousness and brings her back to the village. When she wakes up, she taunts the Emperor and Vader in defiance. Vader then decapitates her with his lightsaber and then is ordered by the Emperor to kill Drua and all of the villagers to erase any evidence of the events. Later that same year, Vader has an unusual request for Grand Moff Tarkin. He requests that Tarkin gather his most dangerous men to hunt Vader on a deserted planet on the Outer Rim. Now, if this isn't the most Darth Vader thing to do, I don't know what is. This is literally just to test himself, his abilities, and his limitations. Or maybe he just had a secret desire to be killed. Tarkin, along with 19 of his men, armed with flamethrowers and slug guns, because Tarkin knew that Vader could deflect blasters with his lightsaber or the Force. And in their first encounter, Tarkin sets him on fire with flamethrowers. And he learns through Vader's body language that Vader actually feared the fire. But Vader escapes and kills many of the hunters. And with each kill, Tarkin learns more and more about Vader's abilities and his weaknesses. He even thought that he'd learn that if he was able to take Vader's lightsaber, that he would become easier to kill. But man, was he wrong. One of the things that fuels Vader is just plain killing. He had no problem killing up close and personal, even without his lightsaber. The angrier he got, the more powerful he became. Vader used the Force to crush windpipes, break bones, and even pull eyes out of their sockets. But as Tarkin watched as his men were brutally killed, Tarkin was learning things like how far away Vader could use the Force to kill someone, what his suit limitations were, and what his limits were with the Force itself. With only Tarkin and a few trackers left, Vader deactivated his breathing apparatus in his suit so he could sneak up on the group. He force chokes one of the trackers and uses the Force to call his lightsaber from Tarkin's belt and at the same time reactivating his breathing device. Vader kills the last two hunters as Tarkin is able to get away, but he runs to a very specific spot out in an open field. Vader makes his way to Tarkin, and as Tarkin falls to his knees, he's seemingly defeated. What Vader doesn't realize is that Tarkin led him to this specific spot on purpose. This place is Stormland, and what Tarkin refers to as the Bad Ground. And as Vader stands above him, a bolt of lightning comes down and strikes Vader, burning his suit and his body and almost killing him. As Tarkin stands over the burnt body of Vader, victorious, Somehow, Vader is able to choke Tarkin with the Force. He brings him to his knees right alongside Vader. He then releases his grip on Tarkin's throat, with both men showing respect as both worthy adversaries and allies. 5 years later, and it seems like every 5 years, Vader gets himself into a little pickle. This time, it's his old master, Obi-Wan Kenobi. Now, I have a theory about which planet they fight on, and I'll get to that in a minute. But after 10 years, Kenobi is tracked to a planet called Mapuzo. Their encounter is brief, and this encounter with his old master is very disappointing. Obi-Wan is not the same Jedi that he was back on Mustafar 10 years ago. He's weak and he's broken, so this fight, I mean, I guess we can call it a fight. It doesn't last very long, and Kenobi escapes, or more accurately, Vader lets him go. Obi-Wan eventually gets his groove back, and he's trying to get some refugees off of Jabim. He comes up with a plan to take a small ship and act as a decoy to let the refugees escape, because he knows Vader is gonna follow him. They end up on a planet that is, as of now, unnamed. The battle is much different than the one on Mapuzo. Obi-Wan has reconnected with the Force. The fight is pretty even until Vader uses the Force to break the ground beneath Obi-Wan, giving him the high ground. Vader then throws the high ground on top of Obi-Wan, burying him. Vader walks away, thinking he's won, but not so fast, Darth. Obi-Wan, knowing his responsibility to the Skywalker children, his path, and his destiny, he uses the Force to blast the rocks and the debris away and goes once again after Vader. This time, Obi-Wan, Jedi Master Obi-Wan Kenobi, with the Force as his ally, just throws everything, literally everything he has at Vader. He smashes the center control of his suit and then cuts Vader's mask, revealing the face of his former apprentice. Vader, on his knee, struggling to breathe, would have died here if Obi-Wan once again didn't just walk away. Now, the planet that they're on hasn't been named, but I've tried to do a bit of digging. Based on the proximity to Jabim and the way this planet looks, I think that this might be Malachor, or at least in the Malachor system. It looks a lot like Malachor 5 with the rocky spires and the desolate landscape. It would also tie poetically into the next event. So 6 years after his fight with Obi-Wan, Ahsoka, Ezra Bridger, Kanan Jarrus head to Malachor to find a Sith temple where a holocron was located that could help them defeat Vader and Darth Sidious. Darth Maul is also there looking for the holocron as well. Ezra finds a holocron with the help of Maul and then takes it to the top of the temple to place it in the obelisk. Maul is then fought off by Kanan. At the obelisk, Vader shows up with his TIE X-1. Now is the moment when Ahsoka and Vader finally meet. Former master and apprentice. Man, for me, this is a heavy scene. Two of my favorite characters. The bond that Anakin and Ahsoka had and their meeting now, it hits hard. But he gives Ahsoka a choice. They don't have to fight if she agrees to help him hunt down the remaining Jedi. Of course, Ahsoka says no. Vader then threatens to kill Ezra as Ahsoka becomes disgusted, saying her former master could never be as vile as you, acknowledging that Anakin is finally gone. Vader confirms this by saying that Anakin was weak and that he had destroyed him. Of course, Ahsoka will avenge his death as they battle. The battle is close, but Vader eventually forces Ahsoka over the edge to the level below. Vader then turns his attention to the holocron. Ahsoka, she fights back, knocking away his lightsaber and cutting his mask, revealing the face once again of Anakin Skywalker. This is why, at least poetically, that Malachor is where he fought Obi-Wan. Both him and Ahsoka were able to destroy one of the halves of Vader mask, Obi-Wan the left and Ahsoka the right. It makes sense to me that to tie it together even further, that both of these fights would be on Malachor. Vader gets his lightsaber back after an emotional moment where we hear Anakin's voice calling Ahsoka. Ahsoka. Vader reignites the lightsaber as they continue to fight, and as Ezra and Kanan escape, the temple explodes, seemingly killing both Vader and Ahsoka. Later in the episode, we see Vader limping away as he slowly makes his way back to the ship, and we see just a quick glimpse of Ahsoka going down and disappearing down into the dark. Now, Vader's mask being cut in both Ahsoka and Obi-Wan's fight was actually inspired by the Legends comic series, Star Wars Dark Times, where he killed a Jedi Enclave on Kessel. About About a year after his battle with Ahsoka on Malachor, he's tasked by Palpatine to travel to Batuu with Grand Admiral Thrawn to investigate a great disturbance in the Force on the border of the Unknown Regions. On Batuu, they are interested in an alien species called the Darshi. They are a new arrival to the planet and have disrupted trade. They arrive at a place called the Black Spire Cantina, a place familiar to both Vader and Thrawn. Back in the Clone Wars, Anakin Skywalker and Thrawn had met and become allies in Anakin's search for Padme. Inside the cantina, Vader and Thrawn are attacked by 10 Darshi warriors. They fire blasters at the two, but also deploy a swarm of bioengineered insects that would explode on impact, leaving a gray, sticky paste that turns to something like concrete. Vader is hit by these insects and becomes immobilized in his arms and legs. Just as he is about to be completely covered in this weird concrete, he uses the Force and frees himself, igniting his lightsaber and killing the Darshi warriors who were controlling the insects, and escapes with Thrawn back to their ship. Several years after Batuu, Vader's life is finally taken by Anakin Skywalker with the help of his son Luke. Both Obi-Wan and Ahsoka were only able to cut half of Vader's mask off in their fights, while Luke is the only one able to remove his entire mask and saving Anakin Skywalker. I still wonder if Yoda would have been able to save Anakin from turning to the dark side. There's this theory I have, which involves him and Qui-Gon. If you want to check it out, click here on this video right here. Or if you want to see some more cool facts about Grand Admiral Thrawn, click here, and may the Force be with you.